people, it's your girl Adeola. So last week, a video surfaced of Nigerian soldiers collapsing because of lack of water to drink.
Look at soldier, Boko Haram not touching nothing because of water. He faint up because of water. More than 70 soldiers fall today. No water. This is our 3 days here now. We day now, no water here. No water, no food. We just they suffer. Look at soldier, they faint.
I made the airport pass this message to our president. Will they die for you?
No. No problem. We will know what to do.
See how soldiers they fall.
We have a comment to say.
Can you believe this? And then the army came out saying that, oh, they've provided boreholes for the soldiers, that this happened 6 months ago. I said, shoot, did it happen or did it not? And who cares when it happened? And then they said that the video was released by a mischievous and disgruntled element. But okay, I'm like, why? Really? First of all, why do we call people elements in Nigeria? As in elements. Why? So people are now mischievous and disgruntled because they exposed the inhumane treatment of our soldiers. Lord. Father, I wonder how they describe me. Call it a war, you should be worried. I can only imagine how they describe you. You always exposing all those corrupt people. You better watch your back, my brother. So people are now disgruntled for exposing inhumane treatment. The devil is a liar. And then the army said, it is disheartening that some mischievous elements have decided to circulate this video, creating the false impression that it is a recent occurrence. I'm like, it happened 6 months ago. How about? It's not like it happened 2-3 years ago. Buhari was already president. Should this happen under a man that was an army general? Is this the change that Buhari promised? If this was under Jonathan, APC will use it as propaganda. Or not be so, I beg you, that's one story. You would think that because Buhari used to be in the military, the Ali soldiers will be taken care of. By the way, let me talk to the Nigerian army. You know what? No, never mind. What? I should. They never take me serious. You want me to talk to them? Okay, Nigerian army. You know, do it. Okay. Let me give you one advice. Just one advice. You need to stop trying too hard to have a good image, you know? Especially by downplaying something that is obviously horrible. Soldiers are collapsing and getting drips. When they are not fighting Boko Haram, they did not eat for 4 days. Did not drink for 4 days. Hapa! Instead of you to attack the whistleblowers, you would have better image by admitting that this thing happened and that it is a disgrace that it happened. And then you can say, but this is what we've done since it happened, you know? Apparently, one soldier embezzled the water meant for other soldiers. Can I say embezzled water? Wait. They said that he mischievously concealed the water tank. So, in fact, kudos to them for waiting this long. I wouldn't wait that long before releasing the video. I would release the video the same day. While it is happening, go. Anyway, speaking of Mr. President and my Oga, yeah, welcome. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. Welcome to this program. It's been a long time. But seriously, Mr. President, let me look you in the eye. Why? I've said this on this program several times. Why now? I'm always saying that I'm on speed dial, that you can call me before you say anything or release any statement. As you guys know, on the 22nd of this month, Mr. President was scheduled to be in Enugu for the Economic and Security Summit, but he did not go. 48 hours to the event, though, Biafran said that if Buhari should come to Enugu or any Biafra land, that they would kill him. To cut a long story short, Buhari did not go. Me, I didn't think much of it. I'm thinking, okay, maybe he couldn't make it or whatever. Imagine my shock when the presidency released a statement. I said, they say poor. I always tell them to call me. They did not. They said that Buhari did not go because the date was close to Christmas. Find out why. Oh my god, really? I mean, that is even worse. You know, a lot of Biafrans believe he didn't go because of their threat. But this excuse that you came up with, it's better if you didn't say anything. Papa, Oga Buhari, you know too well. Anyway, the presidency said that some elders from the southeast were the ones that came and advised him not to go because it's too close to Christmas and it could be disruptive, whatever. So maybe that is what happened for real. I don't know. But really, it's so funny that this is the excuse that the presidency was giving. So they may be right. I don't know. Maybe they begged him not to come, but it's just really funny. And speaking of Biafra, should I talk about Biafra? Because get ready, because they will call you a prostitute. Okay, it's me that they will call a prostitute. Whenever we talk about Biafra on this show, people attack us. They call me a prostitute. They call me Yoruba prostitute. And then when we don't talk about Biafra, it becomes another issue. They are very upset that we don't talk about Biafra. And if we talk about Biafra, they call us prostitute. It's like there's no way to please some of my Biafran brothers and sisters. You know, do well. But today we will talk about Biafra. So why is the presidency still keeping Nnamdi jammed the canal. I honestly don't see why they've kept him for so long. It's been a year, and then I heard that they were trying to try him in secret. And I'm like, no, that is not right. Since when did we start trying people in secret in Nigeria? Really, Oga Buhari?
Having said that, what does he mean by he would expose secrets that would sink Nigeria? The guy said he would destroy Nigeria completely with evidence.
I don't know who I am. I will destroy Nigeria completely with evidence. I will kill this over here.
And why can't he just say it instead of putting us in suspense?
Not only that, Human Rights Watch said that more than 150 Biafrans have been killed by the Nigerian police during protests. And I'm like, is it possible that Mr. President did not hear about this because, you know, he reads the news? Because there is absolutely no reason to kill people because they say that they want to secede from Nigeria. By now, he should have released a statement to condemn the killing of Biafrans during protests and to hold those responsible accountable. I've said several times on this show that whether you agree with Biafrans or you don't agree with Biafrans, there is absolutely no reason to kill people because they say that they want to secede. Two people can agree to disagree and life goes on. You guys know I don't know much. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. So last year, a Nigerian woman in Delaware stabbed and killed her husband. I'm talking about 35-year-old Temitope, who was married to 37-year-old Adeyinka Adebamiro. When the news broke out, his family members said that the man was an excellent man. Many people said that his wife had been cheating on him for years and that she has been using juju on him. That is a black magic. In fact, the wife's sister also said at that time that her sister was sleeping around and smoking marijuana and using black magic on her husband before she killed him. Well, last week, Temitope was sentenced to 4 years in prison for stabbing and killing her husband. The judge apparently found some overwhelming evidence about what had been going on in their home for years. First of all, they found scars on the woman's body from abuse from her husband. Apparently, her husband had been beating her for years. And they also found out that some of the wounds were inflicted on her when she was pregnant, according to doctor's report. Not only that, they found several sex tapes. Apparently, the husband was sleeping with prostitutes and he would film himself sleeping with prostitutes in his matrimonial home. Apparently, he sent her to Nigeria for her to just go and stay in Nigeria. So the last time that she went to Nigeria, when she came back, she wasn't allowed into her matrimonial home. She stayed in a hotel for 4 days. As a matter of fact, according to her, he told her to go and stay with a pastor in Nigeria and he already bought the plane ticket, but she didn't go. So she stayed in a hotel for days before she could go into her matrimonial home. And then she was made to sign a postnuptial agreement, an agreement that she has no entitlement to any of his wealth, or should I say their wealth, because they were married for 10 years. He had 6 pharmacies in Philadelphia here in the US, so he was making a lot of money. So he wanted to make sure that she's not entitled to any of the money that he was making. The postnuptial agreement also said that she's not allowed to cry in her home and that she would not have a say in the upbringing of their children, an 8-year-old and a 5-year-old. So the agreement said that the nanny is the one that has total control over the kids. Investigators found that agreement that she had signed on the husband's computer. They also found out that her husband, the 37-year-old man, was selling some prescription pills illegally at his pharmacies, making $20,000 each week. Apparently, they've been investigating this man on the issue of selling the drugs for a while. The wife was actually in prison when she learned about the issue of him selling the drugs illegally. She heard by receiving a federal forfeiture notice that the government wants to seize about $300,000 from her late husband. However you look at it, this is a tragic story, and I've been thinking a lot about how we can prevent another of such occurrence in the Nigerian community here in the US. In fact, not just the Nigerian community, because this could happen in any community. I'm especially worried because this is not the first time that such is happening. Not long ago, some Nigerian men here in the US were killing their wives. There was one that happened in California where the husband tied his wife to a car and dragged her around town until her head split open and she died. There was another one that happened in Maryland that the husband shot his wife. And then there was one that happened in Minnesota, and at least 3 Nigerian men killed their wives in Texas. A couple of these guys actually used hammer to kill their wives, and there were some of them that bought guns and they gunned down their wives. A lot of these women were nurses. The main issue is that these women became more successful than their husbands. They started making more money than their husbands, and the husbands felt disrespected. In all of these cases though, there are reports of domestic abuse. Evidently, domestic abuse among us Africans here in the US is something that needs to be discussed. It's something that needs to be addressed, because from what we are seeing, when not addressed, some people end up killing each other. I agree that some people are not physically dead, but to be honest with you, some people are emotionally dead. A lot of people are enduring their marriage, and that's not right. You're so supposed to enjoy your marriage. So these are just my observations regarding their story, as well as my suggestions regarding domestic violence. Now, it may look like I'm upset, and yes, I am upset, but you guys know I don't know much. These are just like my suggestions. So I don't know the whole truth about this story, mainly because the husband is no longer alive for us to hear his side of the story. And of course, I strongly condemn the fact that she killed her husband. She should not have killed her husband. No matter what was going on, killing him was not the solution. But having said that, I have a real problem with this woman. Like, seriously, why? Why do so many women endure things that they should not endure because of culture or religion? You mean to tell me that a man has been beating you all these years and you did not speak out or get help? He even beat you and wounded you when you were pregnant to the point where you had to go to the hospital for treatment. Your husband is sleeping with prostitutes. You even saw the sex tapes and you did not report him. According to her, the night that she killed him, the guy had found out that she used her cell phone to take some of the pictures from the sex tape. So according to her, he found out and he got really, really mad. And then only God knows what happened. Keep in mind, the woman gave two versions of what happened that night. So evidently, she wasn't straightforward. So you found the sex tapes and you did not report him. And better still, you did not leave, you stayed. After watching your husband sleeping with other women, I don't understand that. He made you sign an agreement that you will not raise the children that you gave birth to. And he said that you're not allowed to cry in your own house. And you signed it. Why? Why would anybody do that? And please, I'm not saying that she's innocent. They may have been abusing each other and she may be the only one that was being abused. I don't know how the situation progressed, but what I do know is that she's not the only woman enduring domestic abuse and covering it up. A lot of women are covering up abuses in their homes. So I'd like to talk to my ladies today. Please, please, I beg of you. If you're in an abusive relationship, please, you need to value your life and run. Don't wait until you are killed and don't wait until you kill somebody. If he kills you, life goes on without you. In fact, he may marry another woman when he comes out of prison. If you kill him, how will you tell your children that you killed their father? And of course, you will go to prison. So why are you waiting until something very, very bad happens before you leave? Some people will say, well, you should just stay and pray. Me, I'm saying that if somebody is beating you every night, there is no way you can concentrate even on the prayer. You need to leave first. Go to where you can pray if you want to pray. And I also believe in prayers, but I would never advise anybody to stay in an abusive relationship. Your life is more important than for you to have the title of Mrs. And if it's a guy that is being abused, it's better for you to stay alive than for you to say you have a married status. So I know that it's not easy for someone to just get up and leave, especially for some women that have no resources. The husband did not allow them to work, so the woman may not have any personal money of her own that she could spend in order for her to escape if she's being abused. Some people will say, what if he comes after me and he kills me? That's why you need to have a plan. You need to find an organization that defends and works with victims of domestic abuse or somebody that you can trust. And it doesn't have to be a family member, because some family members will betray you. They will say, are you not cooking fufu for him? Are you not having sex with him? In fact, in some cases, a total stranger would help you. And you know, I'm sorry to say this, but a lot of African pastors here, they make me mad when it comes to how they handle domestic abuse. Please, men of God and women of God, whatever advice you will not give your own daughter if her husband is beating her up, please don't give it to somebody else's daughter. I watched a video not long ago of a Nigerian lady in a church saying that her husband was beating her up whenever he drinks. And can you believe that the women of God that were on the panel, they were saying there must be something that the woman was doing wrong. And I was like what? And I'm thinking, seriously? This whole idea of a woman has to do something wrong to warrant beatings is so not right. There are women that are doing everything right, yet the man beats her regularly. According to one man, he said that it is to keep his wife in place so that she would know that he's the one in charge. So stop saying that a lady must be doing something wrong. And even if she's doing something wrong, beating her is not right. These same women of God giving advice and these same men of God giving advice, if their own daughter is getting beat up by her husband, the first thing they would tell her is come home immediately. There is no father in his right mind that would let somebody else beat up his daughter. So please, whatever advice you will not give your own daughter, even though you are a pastor, don't give it to church members. This applies to men as well. If your wife is abusing you, you better speak out and get help. Don't say, oh, how do I tell people that my wife is beating me? Hey, my brother, you don't want to die there. A lot of things can be avoided, by the way, if we don't ignore the red signals that we see while we're dating somebody. To the single ladies, if you notice anything in the guy that you are dating, please do not ignore red signals. A lot of women see some things before they get into marriage. marriage and they ignore it. The same thing goes for men. If you're noticing something in a lady that you're dating and you know that I cannot live this with for the rest of my life, then don't go into marriage with the person. Too many people think that they can change someone after they are married to the person. No, you can never change anybody. You cannot, because you are not God. And some people will say that they will pray, that their prayer will change the person. He will get born again. He will become a devoted Muslim. No, let me tell you, if your prayer doesn't change him or her before you get married, it will not change the person after you get married. People don't change just because they exchange some vows. If he's controlling while you're dating, chances are it will continue to be controlling after you get married. And it goes both ways. If your opinion did not matter while you are dating, it will not matter after you get married to the person. I've seen men that won't let their wives work once they get in the US, or even let them make friends. They will say just stay home and have kids. And in most cases, they threaten this woman with papers. They tell her that without me, you can't have your green card or your citizenship. And then she's also afraid. Why would you tell a lady that you love her and then you marry her and make her leave home, leave her family, only for you to bring her here and treat her like crap? Please, my sister, if you are in that situation, you need to get help. You will not get deported for reporting domestic abuse. And then there are some women that will put up with crap because they are getting money. Please, my sister, if you are putting up with abuse because the guy is giving you money after beating you up, the day he will beat you up and kill you, somebody else will spend all the money that he's been giving you. But you know, reading about this story, one thing that bothered me is his family. You know, I keep asking myself, his family, because they said that he was a great guy. In fact, when the story broke last year, they were saying that the woman is the wicked one. They were saying that, oh, she was the one cheating on him and that she was using juju on him, but evidence proved otherwise. And please, I'm not saying that she's innocent. They may have been abusing each other. So while I sympathize with his family for losing their son, evidently he must have been a breadwinner. I don't know if he was the only breadwinner, but he was probably taking good care of them. I mean, he had chains of pharmacies, so I'm sure that he was taking care of his family. So while I sympathize with them for their loss, is it really possible that his family did not know at all how he was treating his wife? Is it really possible that they did not notice anything for 10 years? 10 years of marriage. If you're watching me today, maybe you're not being abused and maybe you are not abusing anyone, but maybe you know of an abuse that is going on. Please don't keep quiet. Please do not keep quiet. Even if the abuser is close to you, please do not keep quiet, because you just never know whose life you are going to save. You may save somebody's life. You may think that the person that is being abused will eventually leave, but what if that person doesn't leave? And what if he or she kills the person that you are close with? We should not condone violence, even if we are benefiting from the abuser. Also, if you are the one abusing your wife or your husband, I feel really bad for you. Like, see, I feel really bad for you that you have to put someone else down before you can feel good about yourself. And abuse is not only physical. Some husbands would tell their wives that you can never be anything important. You will never become somebody. And every day he would abuse her verbally to the point that she starts believing it. And it's also vice versa. Some women will also tell their husband every day that you can never amount to anything. And then some men think that the sky would fall if their wife should become successful or more successful than they are. You know, the Nigerian men that kill their wives because their wives became more successful. Can you imagine that mentality? So if you're watching me today and you're abusing somebody, it may be working for you now. You may think that you have it under control, it's working for your benefit, but let me tell you, it's only a matter of time. Someday you will either be arrested or that person will escape and you will be exposed and everybody will know about your secret life, or you will kill somebody someday even though you didn't plan it. I've heard about husbands that did not plan on killing their wives. It just happened. They were just beating her like they normally would, and then she died, and all of a sudden everybody knew about what had been going on. So you may kill somebody someday, and of course you will go to prison for that, or somebody may kill you if she's been enduring or he's been enduring. The day the person will snap, they may kill you. Either way, it's not going to end well if you're abusing somebody. You may think that the person is stupid putting up with your crap today, but the day that he or she will snap, they will do something drastic that you won't even see it coming. So why wait and not seek help today? If you're abusing somebody, you can also get help. There are domestic violence centers in every city here in the US. You can go and get help. You will not be arrested if you go and get help. Lastly, let me talk to the single ladies. A lot of men will come home. Some Nigerians will go to Nigeria looking for wives. Please do not be deceived by the fact that he lives in America. You have no idea the kind of life that he's living in America. One man told a woman that he's a medical doctor in America, and then she married him. Getting to America, though, she found out that he only cleans the hospital floors. He's not a medical doctor. I'm just saying that don't be deceived by the dollars that he's giving you or think that once you get to America, you've entered into wealth. No, it's not always true. This does not apply to all men, by the way. I'm not saying that all men living abroad are bad. No. So please don't get me wrong. I'm just saying that do your research very well. Do your research very well so that you don't become a victim. I really hope you guys will read This American Life Self, written by my colleague Dr. Damages, Rudolph Okonkwo. I talked about this book on my YouTube page. It's titled What African Immigrants Go Through in America. You can buy it on Amazon if you're living in Nigeria. It has been published in Nigeria as well, because this could happen in any community. It's very unfortunate that the guy died. You know what the judge said? If only this woman came out and reported all the abuse going on in her home, based on the evidence that they found, that the man would have faced up to 20 years in prison. So please stop enduring suffering. You guys not doing much. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. Moving on to the Democratic Republic of Congo. Not only did we not have elections this year, you guys know that we were supposed to have an election last month, right? But President Kabila's second term officially ended on December 19th. And guess what? The man has refused to step down. So guess what happened? People took to the streets on the 20th of December demanding that he must step down. They said that 15 years is enough. They were saying that Kabila, your mandate has ended. His father was the former president of Congo, as you guys know. And when his father was assassinated, he took over and he served one term. And then they had an election in 2006, which he rigged, and he became the elected president. And then they had another election in 2011, and he rigged that one as well. People complained, but he rigged that one as well. Now he wants third term. By the way, the West backed him both times. In case you wonder why, the US, for example, their aerospace industry depends on the coltan and the minerals in Congo. So that is just one thing. All the laptops, the cell phones, the plasma TV, they all depend on Congo. So they turn blind eyes to what is happening in Congo. More than 6 million people have been killed in Eastern Congo because of the interest of developing countries in the natural resources of Congo. So according to the constitution, Kabila is not supposed to do a third term, although technically he's been there for three terms, but he doesn't want to hold an election until 2018. He's saying that due to logistical and financial constraints. This man thinks that Congolese people are stupid. Really? Like, how could you? Really? He thinks that they are stupid with all the money that his family had been stealing, and he wants to remain president until 2018. That is when he said they will suddenly have money to hold an election. Unfortunately, when people started protesting, more than 40 people have been killed, according to the United Nations. Soldiers literally opened fire on protesters. And guess what they are doing now? They are going from house to house, arresting young people so that they won't protest. So now they've arrested about 460 people. Congolese people living in the diaspora have also been protesting as well. In South Africa, for example, Congolese people protested at the Congolese embassy in South Africa, and they are asking South African government to stop sending soldiers to Congo because South Africa is indirectly supporting a dictator. Also, in France, the Congolese community has been protesting, saying that he must step down. A Congolese man in the diaspora has declared Kabila wanted, and he's offering $100,000 to anyone that can provide information on Kabila's whereabouts, because right now people don't know where he is, he's hiding. And the same man is also offering $1 million to anyone that can kill Kabila. He's saying that the person will be considered a hero. Me, I'm not in support of that. You know, let the law prevail. You should look for a way to kick him out, not because you want to win money, but you should kick him out because you want a better government. I don't think you should kill him, because killing him means that you're not better than Kabila himself. Last week, Bloomberg here in the US released a report that Kabila and his family have created a business fortune for themselves in the form of 70 companies in Congo after Congolese regulators computerized and made government and corporate records publicly available. Also, documents obtained show that Kabila and his wife and their two children and eight of his siblings have 120 permits to dig gold, diamond, copper, cobalt, and other minerals. And keep in mind that the wealth in Congo is so much that no Congolese person should be living in poverty. Yet, these people have made it all theirs. The document also revealed that his family has stakes in the banks, the firms, fuel distribution, airline operations, road building, hotels, pharmaceutical supplies, travel agencies, boutiques, and nightclubs. The network that the Kabila family has created is so complex that even the rent paid by UN officials in Congo finds its way to Kabila's family. So there is no separation between what belongs to Kabila and what belongs to the country. In other words, whatever Congo owns, he's laying claims on it, him and his family. Now you know why he doesn't want to step down. So he's trying to bribe the opposition by dissolving his whole cabinet and adding some people from the opposition in his cabinet. And people are like, no, we don't want to be part of your cabinet. We want you to leave. Now opposition members are in dialogue with the Kabila's administration to see if they can let him rule on until November 2017. And I'm like, what happens if 2017 comes and the man still refuses to step down? They are yet to sign this agreement, but a lot of people are already calling them traitors. What if November 2017 comes? That is like 11 months to come, right? What if he comes and the man still insists that he's not stepping down? Anyway, whether he likes it or not, he will be kicked out by fire, by force. You guys know, I don't know much. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. So moving on to the Gambia, you guys will not believe that despite ECOWAS intervention, Yahya Jammeh has refused to step down and he's still insisting on another election.
ECOWAS came here, the results they announced are the will of the Gambian people. I said, how the hell do you know that this is the will of the Gambian people when 360,000 have not voted? Who are they to tell me to leave my country?
By the way, Gambian ambassador to the US has resigned, you know? Jammeh is telling the man to come back home, but I don't think he should go. So what I don't understand right now is why some Nigerian lawyers who call themselves the African Bar Association are supporting Yahya Jammeh. Who are these people? Look at these people. The Nigerian Bar Association has already condemned his action and they are saying that he should respect the wish of the people and step down since they voted him out. But these ones call themselves the African Bar Association. They said they are based in Nigeria and they went to Gambia praising Yahya Jammeh left and right.
At least the president has been there for some time, so it's not like he's learning. He doesn't know what are the problems. He also has a notion of where he was leading his country to. Not everybody will like Mr. President, but the important thing is that it's between you and Allah.
You know what some people will do because of money? You will be surprised. Why? Why now? You know Jammeh took a petition to court challenging the result of the election. So these Nigerians are saying that what Jammeh did is lawful and is the right thing to do. That the Gambian court should be the one to decide whether Jammeh should step down or not.
When a court gives judgment, a court has given judgment. The African power wants to state categorically to the international press, we condemn this interference. The court should give its judgment. The court should look at the case and give its judgment.
They said that the petition is great, it's legal and it's constitutional, that there is nothing wrong with it. I'm like, shoo, look at this ones. Where did they find this ones? Like, really, where did they find these people? And they have to be Nigerians for that. Why? Why do they have to be Nigerians? What a disgrace. One of them said that Westerners should mind their business, that Gambia is even safer than Europe.
There is nowhere you go to Europe now that you will not be faced with one terrorist attack or the other every day. You can't move on the street without looking at your shoulder and all that.
Outside. Who, father? My people in Europe, is it true? Are you safe? Please let me know whether you are safe or not. Eh? What did Jammeh give to these people? Shouldn't you be ashamed of yourself? You would think the older people get, the wiser they would become. Can you imagine? Why would Nigerians be interfering with the election results in another country? I mean, Nigerian government needs to address this man. Is it possible for us to have an election in Nigeria and then Gambian lawyers will come and be supporting the president for not wanting to live in Nigeria? Heck no, what? It is not going to happen. So after they praised him up and now they invited him to an event that they would hold, and I was like, this is about him coming to the next morning, no be so.
To join us at the conference, and we do hope then His Excellency, whatever the case is, will be there in Port Harcourt. You know, we know he will be there, and we are going to discuss Africa.
And of course, he said that he would come.
I also want to assure you that by the grace of the Almighty Allah, I have accepted your invitation. And inshallah, I'll be with you.
You know, in the end, Yahya Jammeh talked jargons like he normally would.
I have always been a man of peace, and I will always be a man of peace until I leave this world. My relationship with Allah is more important than my relationship with any creature. But I also believe in one thing, that whatever Allah decides is what is going to happen.
Yeah, everything has to do with Allah, you know. I thought he said that he will leave when Allah tells him to leave. Alhamdulillah, a few weeks ago, Allah told him to leave. No, be so. Did Allah change his mind or what happened? Please tell me. I really want to know. You think Allah changed his mind? Or is it Yahya Jammeh that is using the name of Allah as excuse for his own interest? Right now, ECOWAS is saying that they will send troops to Gambia in January if Yahya Jammeh did not step down by the 19th when he's supposed to step down. So, my brother, seriously, I don't think you should wait until they send soldiers to Gambia. Me, I'm just saying my own. But you know, he said something that is very true, Daddy.
I know I made many enemies. Do I care? I don't. I care about what my relationship with Allah and the Gambian people.
Of course, we know that he doesn't care. But guess what, Yahya Jammeh? We also don't care. That is why we know that you are the biggest bigot and such a coward. In fact, you are a chicken. You are doing all this because you are a chicken. We also don't care anymore. Maybe we've been courteous, you know. We should just spell it out for you. You are good for nothing. Seriously, you are good for nothing, right? You are just big-headed. There is nothing right here. Step down, my man. You need to step down. You guys know I don't know anything with Daddy. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. So as you guys know, James Ibori, the Ogirigo Girigbo of Africa, has been released. Oh yes, the former governor of Delta State. After he served 4 years in the UK prison, he was convicted of stealing $250 million, among other things. So a lot of people have been celebrating his release, by the way. Some people are celebrating in Delta.
Now they know what it means, they arrest them. So
we don't know
about the arrest. What do we know about? They don't release our brother. Our brother don't come again. We don't say we go enjoy again. What is it going to go? PDP. Now they share the money.
Ibori stole money from the Niger Delta people. No, be so.
When I heard it was released yesterday, there was still a celebration, and I heard somebody who died in the course of celebrating.
It happened during the celebration, though. The person is a cyclist rider, so before we got there, the guy has already died.
I mean, sometimes I don't understand some things. Their main excuse is that, well, he's not the only thief. What about Tinubu? What about Obasanjo? What about this? What about that? And some people are celebrating with him in London.
James Ibori made his success. There may never be the governor in Nigeria history again who will sit in his cell or in the prison and make a governor.
Sometimes I wonder how God feels about some things, you know. And keep in mind, the EFCC says that if he returns to Nigeria, then they will arrest him. So Nigerians have divided opinions about this issue. So I want to know what you guys think about Ibori and people celebrating his release. Please put down your thoughts in the comments below. If you guys not know much, guess what? I'm just keeping it real.
Growing up in Kenya, my sister and I were very close. But like any sisters, we fought a lot. She always got new clothes, and I always got hand-me-downs. Now, she's putting her children through school in Kenya. We still fight sometimes, especially when I send money for the kids. I tell her, buy some clothes for the younger one, and we both laugh.
With nearly 500,000 locations, our app and online, this is Moving Money for Better.
By the way, Kwale Dawo did really well this year, y'all. Didn't he? Please give him a round of applause, you know? So from me and Kwale Dawo, we just would like to wish you a Merry Christmas and a wonderful New Year. Kwale Dawo has to travel next week for the New Year celebration, so there won't be an episode next week. But of course, I will miss you guys. I'll see you in 2017. By the way, before we go, I just want to thank everybody for watching this show this year. Y'all, amazing. Without you, there is no show. So thank you all for putting up with me throughout this year. And more importantly, thank you for putting up with Kalido. That is another case. You guys are wonderful. Thank you very much for watching the show. All right, y'all, it's been real, and I'm keeping it real right up in here. Don't forget to follow me on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Until next year, 2017, I must see y'all later. Peace out.